All praise is due to Allah who has blessed us with the great month of Ramadan, a month of forgiveness, a month of mercy, a month of liberation from the hellfire. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once described Ramadan in the following words: فَقَالَ sallallahu alaihi wasallam أَوَّلُهُ رَحْمَةً وَأَوْسَطَهُ مَغْفِرَةً وَآخِرُهُ عِتْقٌ مِنَ النَّارِ. That its first 10 days, its first third embodies mercy, its middle third embodies forgiveness, and its latter third liberation from the hellfire. And as Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali says in his commentary on this, بَلْ كُلُّهُ رَحْمَةً وَكُلُّهُ مَغْفِرَةً وَكُلُّهُ عِتْقٌ مِنَ النَّارِ. All of it is mercy, all of it is forgiveness, all of it is liberation from the hellfire. But during these particular times, those qualities predominate. So the mercy predominates in the first part, forgiveness in the middle part, and liberation from the hellfire in the latter part. During the last 10 days of Ramadan, which we're in, these are described as the greatest nights of the year. Most of our scholars say the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are more virtuous than the days of Ramadan. But the last 10 nights of Ramadan are more virtuous than all other nights. So this is a blessed time. It's a time we seek out Laylatul Qadr. We seek it out on the odd nights of the last 10 days of Ramadan. And this is why we spend all 10 days seeking it out. Something that many people, something that escapes many people. And that is, if the night of power is sought out on the odd nights of the last 10 nights of the month, if it's a 29-day month, which is a possibility, then the last 10 nights start on the 19th. And the odd nights will be the 19th, the 21st, the 23rd, etc. And if it's a 30-day month, then the last 10 days will start on the 20th. And the odd nights will be the 20th, the 22nd, the 24th, etc. So the believer, not knowing if it's going to be a 29-day month or a 30-day month, and this Ramadan we're truly in doubt. And so we spend all of those nights seeking out the night of, or seeking the night of power. And Allah Ta'ala describes the night of power in the Qur'an. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. That we have sent down the Qur'an in the night of power, that we could say in the night of decrees. Wa ma adraka ma laylatul qadr. What will bring you to realize what the night of power is? Laylatul qadr khayrun min alf shahr. The night of power is better than 1,000 months. Why is that? Some of our scholars say that the earlier nations, as we know, for example, the people of Nuh alayhi salam, they lived to be 1,000 years. They lived to be 800, 900 years, 1,200 years. But the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the average lifespan is 60 some odd years. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away at 63 years old. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu passed away at 63 years old. Umar radiallahu anhu passed away at 63 years old. This is the average life, the 60s, 70s. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His mercy, since we don't have 800 years to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or we don't have 900 years or 1,000 years to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ta'ala has given the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Laylatul Qadr. And He says the worship in this night is like the worship of 1,000 months. Is even more virtuous, is better. Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alf shahr. The night of power is better than 1,000 months. So we don't get to live 1,000 years to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we have one night every year that's worth 83 years. 1,000 months equates to over 83 years. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy and His favor to the community of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has shortened our lifespans. But in that lifespan, He's given us one night every year. The worship therein is better than the worship of 1,000 months. So why are you watching television? Why are you spending all night eating? It's one thing to break the fast, but it's another thing to just hang around socializing for the next 4 or 5 hours. When there's a night whose worship is worth 1,000 months, and not just any 1,000 months. It's related that this 1,000 months is 1,000 months of a man from the Bani Israel, from the earlier communities, who put on his armor and took his weapons and went forth and defended the religion for 1,000 months. And he worshipped Allah while he was in his armor with his weapons, defending the religion for 1,000 months. The night of power, the worship is better than his 1,000 months. So not just a chronological demarcation of time, but the 1,000 months of a man who's worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while wearing his armor and defending the faith. Laylatul Qadr is better than that 1,000 months. And then Allah ta'ala says, subsequently, تَنَزِّلُ الْمَلَائِكَ. The angels descend. And when the angels descend, they have something in their mind. What is in their mind? Allah Ta'ala relates in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا وَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. When your Lord said to the angels, verily I'm going to create in the earth a vicegerent, they said, who you place therein, one who will work much corruption and shed blood while we glorify you and sing your praises, glorify your praises and exalt your holiness. And he said, Allah Ta'ala said, verily I know that which you know not. You know the superficial outward manifestation of the human being. But I know the human potential. You know the outward, but I know the inner. And I know that this human being has the potential to do what you do. وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. So when you go down to the earth on Laylatul Qadr, تَنَزُّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ وَالرُّوحُ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. When you go down to the earth during these nights of Ramadan, during these last 10 nights of Ramadan, you will find the human creation. You will find the believers from the Ummah of Muhammad, that they're glorifying their Lord. They're singing the praises of their Lord. They're exalting His holiness. You will find them if you descend in the day, you will find them fasting. And if you descend in the night, you will find them standing in prayer. You will find them reciting the book of Allah. You will find them glorifying the praises of your Lord. You will find them doing what you boasted of. وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. You will find them doing that. But you will find them doing something you are incapable of doing. You do it instinctively. You do it with no choice. They do it voluntarily. They do it of their own free choice. Look at them. Look at Bani Adam. Look at Bani Adam. Look at your masjid during these nights. Look at the believers in Ramadan. Look at the believers during the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Look how they're standing in prayer before their Lord. Look how they're reciting the Book of Allah. And look how peace permeates amongst them. Salamun hiya hatta matla'il fajr. This is the human potential. This is what Ramadan is about, brothers and sisters. It's about getting in touch with our human potential. But our human potential is not flesh and bones. It's not blood. It's not hair. If that's our human potential, then there's nothing to distinguish us from an ape. Well, some people say we're descended from apes. So we'll make it more plain. If that's our human potential, just blood and hair and bones and muscle and flesh, there's nothing to distinguish us from a rat that's crawling around in the sewage. And it's no coincidence that those people who want to deny the spiritual nature and the spiritual essence of the human being, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala breathed into this creature. ثُمَّ سَوَّاهُ وَنَفَخَ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِهِ وَجَعْلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. And he breathed into him of his spirit, not a spirit within him, a spirit that he created, this ruh that he created. He breathed it into the human. And that bequeathed unto the human being consciousness that transcends flesh and bones. It transcends the brain. We were discussing last night with a group of brothers, a book written by a neuroscientist. His name is Ibn Alexander, a world-class neuroscientist who went into a coma for 7 days, lost all brain function. Whatever machine measures brain function, there's a lot of doctors here, whatever you call it, an EKG or whatever, flatline, no brain activity, gone. Yet he was perceiving realms beyond this physical world. His book, we don't say miraculously, we say by the command of Allah, just as the angels and the ruh descend bi-idhni rabbihim. By the command of his Lord, after 7 days, when the doctors had written him off, when the doctors called all of his family members from far and wide to say their last regards, because they were sure he's going out, his brain is dead, he's gone. On the 7th day, after there was superficially massive damage to the cortex of his brain, he sat up in bed and asked, "Where am I?" And within a few months had regained all of his memory, all of his mental functions. And he wrote a book about his experience in that realm beyond this world. And he called his book Proof of Heaven. And as a world-class neurologist, he said there is no physical explanation to what I experienced. So this realm of consciousness is not rooted in the brain. But we already know that. Because we know it's rooted in the heart, but not the physical bump, 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 bump heart. But the qualities that make us human, whose locus is in the heart. This is what we know as believers. And later, Ramadan is to put us back in touch with that by denying our flesh, not feeding our flesh. We feed our ruh. And when we feed our ruh, we release the power that allows us to stand in prayer for 2 or 3 hours and then come back at 4 in the morning and then pick up our Quran and read it without tiring. The only thing stopping us, we have to go to work or we have to tend to some business. That's the only thing that stops us, but we have the spiritual energy to read it all day. That's what Ramadan is doing, is putting us in touch with that aspect of our being from which that spiritual energy emerges. And this is the source of our humanity, not the blood and the flesh. And this is what Ramadan puts us back in touch with. This is the great blessing of Ramadan. And this unlocks the key to taqwa. This unlocks the key. Allah Ta'ala tells us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. That this fast that's been ordained for you believers, it is to open the realms of God consciousness. That translates into obeying God. And then the true, how and where does the obedience come from? It comes from realizing the gravity and magnitude of the Quranic message. These are the three things that Ramadan brings together for us. It brings together the fasting, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ. It brings together the Quran, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانِ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. And it brings together taqwa, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And what does the taqwa do for us? أَلِفْ لَامْ مِيمْ ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا عَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. The taqwa opens up the Qur'an. هُدًى ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا عَيْبَ فِيهِ. This is the scripture, the Qur'an. There's no doubt about it. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is guidance for those who have taqwa. It is guidance for those who fast. And the fast bequeaths unto them taqwa, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. And the taqwa opens up the Qur'an for them. And the Qur'an puts them in touch with something from beyond this world. Because the Qur'an embodies the eternal speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not of this world. It's a vehicle Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us to ride beyond this world. And so when Allah ta'ala describes it, He doesn't describe it with something close that's of this world. He doesn't say, هذا الكتاب لا ريب فيه. Even though it's right here in our hands. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. Because what's in our hands is from beyond this world. But if we internalize this message, it will enhance our consciousness and allow us to move beyond this world while in this world. This is the great gift of Ramadan for those who choose to accept it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفُرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَا قَوْمِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا اللَّهَ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا ونبينا وشفعينا وقرة أعيننا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. الحمد لله. Allah سبحانه وتعالى has blessed us abundantly. He's blessed us with an amazing way of life called Islam. And one should never be ashamed of being a Muslim because of all the negativity that's being directed towards Islam and Muslims. Our identity, our sense of self, is based on our relationship with our Creator. It's not based on what's printed in the newspaper. The same people who are denigrating Islam are the same people who are advocating policies of death and destruction all over this world. The same people who don't have the moral courage to challenge the military-industrial complex that defines, to a large extent, politics in this country, and certainly foreign policy. The atrocities we see, and we won't dwell on. It's Ramadan, we stay positive. But those are the people who are demonizing Islam to make this enemy, to justify their policies. Those are the people who demonize immigrants to justify the massive network of detention centers and private prisons. Those are the people that demonize young African-American youth to make sure that the pipeline from our poorest neighborhoods into our prisons stay open, as opposed to working for policies, enlightened policies, that will seek to educate a child. So there's a pipeline from our poorest neighborhoods to our best schools and universities and colleges, and not to the prison. And then they profit, and they don't have the moral courage to even take a second look at what they're doing. If those people are saying you are bad, I will not lose a minute of sleep worrying about what they say. And someone might say, but it affects people and people are hating us. Then we do the positive things that we do to engender love. You want the people to love the Muslims. You don't need a full page ad in the New York Times. You want people to love the Muslims. You don't need a massive public relations campaign. If you want people to love the Muslims and you want to do your part, do what you're doing in Ramadan, and keep doing it after Ramadan. Fast on Mondays and Thursdays. Keep reciting your Quran. Keep remembering Allah abundantly. And people love the Muslim. Not because I say so, because Allah says so. Allah Ta'ala tells us, if you want love for the Muslim, get on Allah's plan. You don't need to hire a public relations firm from Wall Street. You need to open the Quran, where Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ سَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهَ لَحْمُ رَحْمَانُ وُدَّا. Those who believe and do righteous deeds, Allah will make love for them in the hearts of the people. سَيَجْعَلُ لَحْمُ رَحْمَانُ وُدَّا. Allah will make love in the hearts of the people. So you're going to trust Madison Avenue? You're going to trust the New York Times? Put a nice glossy ad. Are you going to trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I'll put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma aghfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab. ربنا افرغ علينا الصبر وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا افرغ علينا الصبر وثبت اقدامنا وتوفنا مسلمين واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا انت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم انا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن ونعوذ بك من العجز والكسل ونعوذ بك من الجبن والبخل ونعوذ بك من بك من غلبة الدين وقهر الرجال ونعوذ بك من الفقر إلا إليك ومن الذل إلا لك ومن الخوف إلا منك. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تعول به بيننا وبين معاصيك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا بها جنتك ومن اليقين ما يهون علينا مصاعب الدنيا ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عدانا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا يا أرحم الراحمين واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين اللهم انصر المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر إخواننا المسلمين في الشام اللهم انصرهم نصرا من عندك يا الله اللهم انصر المسلمين في سوريا يا الله اللهم انصر المسلمين في فلسطين وفي العراق في أفغانستان في باكستان في الهند في بنغال في 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 مصر اللهم انصر المسلمين في مصر وفي تونس وفي ليبيا في المغرب في موريتانيا في الجزائر في السنغال في السودان في الصومال في كل مكان في تركيا اللهم انصر المسلمين في تركيا يا الله وفي أوروبا اللهم انصرنا في هذا البلد في كل مكان يا الله اللهم من أراد خيرا لهذه الأمة المحمدية فوفق لكل خير ومن أراد شر لها وللمسلمين فخذ أخذ عزيز مقتدر واجعل تدبيرهم تدميرهم اللهم عليك بعداء الإسلام أنت مولانا فانصرنا للقوم الكافرين ونتوسل إليك بجميع أعمال الصالحات قام بها المسلمون في هذا الشهر المبارك يا الله اللهم نتوسل إليك بهذه الأعمال الصالحات كما توسل إليك أصحاب الكهف بما هم فعلوا يا الله فنحن نتوسل إليك بصيامنا وقيامنا وصلاتنا وزكاتنا وسجودنا وركوعنا بهذا يا الله نسألك أن يخفف عن المسلمين يا الله أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أكمل الصلاة يرحمني ويرحمكم الله